Hey, how are you doing? This is Richard Sachs, host from Lost Arts Radio. In case you're a new listener and don't know that, we missed a week and we're on a new time now. But I still remembered how to talk and everything, so it should go all right. And I just want to tell anybody who's new, either listening live now or listening later on the archive, what this is all about. And, you know, our regular show, is Sunday night, tomorrow night, because it's Saturday now. And that's the one that we actually started with, that we were first asked to do. And that's the one where the guests are on. There's incredible guests almost every week, pretty much every single week since we first started, which is amazing to me, because even in the beginning when nobody knew we were there, we had these incredible people wanting to be on. And I took that as a sign that this show was supposed to happen, because it was not my idea. It wasn't Doug's idea to do this originally. And in the beginning, I was asked to help a friend of ours, Dane Wigington, host a show on geoengineering. That's the planes, you know, flying high up in the air and spraying toxic metals and all these other unpleasant things on us every day that you're not supposed to know about. That is a big conspiracy theory, except that it's so widespread now. It's over almost every country. And you can even get degrees in it in the universities of many countries, but of course it doesn't exist and you're crazy if you know about it. So I did know about it, and I helped Dane for a few months in hosting that show, which was really educational at that time. The California drought was being engineered and we watched it being created on radar off the coast of California. You know, I certainly don't know all the details of why they were doing it, but they were definitely doing it. And we would watch the big storms come in, and then these planes would all fly in and dump all this stuff in the path of the storm, and it would disappear and fall 2,000 miles later in the eastern part of the country where it would turn into flood. So that happened. And then when I was done helping Dane with that, I was going to disappear again. And right at that time, the owner of the network that we were on with Dane asked me if I would please do a show on health, because I had a really unusual background in health research and experimentation and interesting things like reversing aging and getting rid of incurable diseases, stuff like that. So I felt like it would be unethical for me to refuse, and that started Lost Arts Radio. But then I knew I didn't know how to do a radio show. Obviously can tell I don't know how to be a radio host even now, you know, a couple of years later, but I certainly didn't know how to do the technical part. And so we had a friend who was another host on Dane's show who had 65,000 people in his Facebook group. And I thought, well, maybe he'll run an ad for me and ask for somebody willing to do, you know, a public service and be the engineer that basically hold the whole show together. And I thought, well, I'll have to interview hundreds of people who are in, you know, unsuited for the job, and then get somebody who I'll just, you know, won't be able to do it with. But that's all I could think of to do. So I advertised to 65,000 people in Russ's group, and one person only answered, and that was Doug Diamond, the perfect person who was willing. I mean, an attitude that is inspirational to me and has helped keep the show running for the whole time, every week. It's incredible. So I took that as another sign that the show should happen. And yet, I really had no desire to be ever seen or heard by the public, and I still don't, really. So the reason it even, you know, that I had the background to begin with to do a health show was that in 1964 or 5, I had some really bad health problems, and I was being treated by the best allopathic medical doctors around at a famous university, and, you know, these really top-notch doctors, and they were, of course, their attitude was to give me really powerful toxic chemicals. They call those medicine, in case you didn't remember, and the body doesn't like those at all. But they haven't figured that out, and that's not covered in their training. So they gave me these really heavy-duty toxic chemicals for, I guess it was at least a year, and they didn't cure me, surprise. So they said, okay, fine, let's start doing surgery. I'm sure if we just start cutting out some of your organs, you'll be in really good shape. So I mean, they put it in much more impressive terms than that. And before they got too far along with that, I escaped, fortunately. I still didn't feel too good, and that started my serious research. I had worked in a medical lab with my father, who was a medical researcher before that, so I had kind of a correct attitude and understanding of it. I got into science real easily. I understood that was looking for what was true and trying to set up experiments. I mean, everybody uses this in their life to some degree. You observe what's going on in the outside world, and you try to notice patterns in your life around you. And then you think, well, this may not be total coincidence. There could be cause and effect going on. And you look for the causes. Okay, if I do this in my life, you know, people react this way, or this kind of thing happens to me. If I run through red lights with cars coming the other way, I get killed in a car crash, right? And hopefully you actually notice that before you have to experiment with it. But the basic idea is to set up experiments like that and figure out what's going on. As it turns out, that is exactly the same approach that has been going on for tens of thousands of years in spiritual exploration, where people wondered, what is going on in the world? What's the purpose of being here? And they started observing and saying, you know, what are the patterns? And, you know, they tried to get in touch with people who already knew some of the answers that would help them save a lot of time and figure it out. And that's still going on. So I was really interested in those things in all different areas. And I also had some other unusual background, I guess you could call it. And I'm not... You know, this is one of the reasons I didn't want to do a radio show or anything like that, because we're going to get into some very unusual stuff. And you're more than welcome to consider me completely crazy, insane, or at least wrong. And that's fine, because I have no desire to convince anybody of anything. The only thing I would convince you of is honor yourself, be true to the guidance that you have inside yourself, live by it, and try to explore and find out what's true and what works for you. You know, even if you're the only one that thinks it, if you are honest and true to yourself, that's worthwhile, and it's better than giving into the peer pressure of the whole rest of the universe. So that's how I felt about it. And when I was born with some memory of time previous to this lifetime. I remember developing as, you know, what they call, what is it? A piece of tissue in the mother, right? Like a fingernail or something. That was me. I remember developing in the womb. And I remember several times previous to that, all of them, you know, on this particular frequency of experience, except for one, which was in between and right before this lifetime. I don't want that to offend anybody. It's not a belief or a philosophy. It's just my memory, like you remember last week. So, you know, I felt like there was something wrong with me as a little kid. I mean, I was fine up until I was about two, and I remembered what I came here to do and the whole thing. And then I got diverted into fear and things that probably came through my parents and other people I knew. And by the time I was a young kid in school, I thought, you know, there's something seriously wrong with me. I don't fit in, and I need to not be here. And it was just grace that I didn't kill myself as a third grader. But it was pretty serious stuff. Later on, I still didn't remember as clearly as I had when I was very young, but I remembered enough to keep pushing me and exploring and researching, and it pushed me through, you know, to escape from the medical doctors, learn the cause and cures of health and disease, that aging is not set, you can reverse it. It's really interesting, at least I think so. And I was interested because I wanted to feel better, but also that I realized if I didn't have to worry about that in my life, that opens up a lot more possibilities of what you can do. Not saying I used the time well, really, looking back on it now, it was all trial and error, and I made so many stupid mistakes. Part of the reason, if I'm going to be sharing any of this stuff, is maybe a few of these things might save you from making some of the mistakes that I made. And, you know, that's one of the reasons for sharing what you know, no matter who you are, with other people that are interested in that, because it might help them And if you help them, you help yourself. And we'll talk about that, how that actually works later. Anyway, so I spent a long time, starting in the mid-60s, exploring health. It led me into organic agriculture. I was very involved in that from the mid-60s as well. I studied with Alan Chadwick when I was a university student in the mid-60s, and that was incredible. That gave me a whole new perspective on nature and how people could fit into it, how this tremendous abundance of superfoods, which are our normal food, could be grown if people learned how to relate to nature. You know, not with chemical fertilizers, obviously, because those were a terrible disaster for the world. Justus von Liebig, a German chemist, came up with that. But by the time he was done, he realized, like Pasteur did with germs, that he made a huge mistake. But what he did is, he was a scientist, but he was a conventionally trained scientist, so his vision was a bit superficial, and he took some plants and he said, oh, I'm going to fix agriculture, right? So he burns up these plants, and then he takes the ashes from the burned up plants and he analyzes what's in them. And he said, aha, I think I figured out the secret for agriculture that people have always missed. And the secret is these ashes have mostly three elements in them. We're going to tie all this together. I know it sounds like I'm rambling around, but I think this will make sense if you just follow me here. So what they mainly found was nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. And so he figured, well, we can synthetically make all those. Actually, the only source of nitrogen for the soil, for plants, for your muscles, for your bloodstream, there's only one source on this whole planet, and that's the atmosphere. And if the air, was it in its normal condition, it's supposed to be about 80% nitrogen, not oxygen. Oxygen's only like 20 or a little over, ideally. But nitrogen is the main gas in the atmosphere. And it's not a coincidence, because what happens is that there are microorganisms in the soil, and along with lightning, they tend to be the mechanism that gets the nitrogen out of the atmosphere into the soil so that the microorganisms can absorb it. And then they make a bridge, especially certain fungi, from the nitrogen into the plant root hairs. And they feed the plants essentially amino acids, which are a primary nutrient of plants, believe it or not. And when you combine that with minerals and other things, then the plants produce superfood for animals and people. So Justus von Liebig said, well, we can just make a factory and take the nitrogen out of the air with this factory and turn it into pellets and sell it to farmers, save them all this time in trying to do compost and all that stuff. And they just buy a bag of pellets, and the same thing for phosphorus and potassium, which come out of rocks instead of the air. And that'll make agriculture, turn out really great. And it did make things grow bigger, but completely unbalanced nutrition. And then the insects and the diseases, who are not in nature by chance, they said, okay, there's unbalanced nutrition for these plants. We have to go wipe them out, because if we let them stay there, then the plants produce more unbalanced nutrition plants in the future, and it ruins the whole races of plants. And that made it appear that the pesticides were needed, and the whole big agricultural poison industry started. So it was a misunderstanding of what should have been science. The same thing happened with the germ theory and a bunch of other stuff. And I was putting all these things together over decades, a long time, more than 50 years. And it just got more and more interesting. At the same time, I traveled around India and places outside the U.S. looking for spiritual teachers, not who could tell me what to memorize, but who had experienced something beyond the physical level. And I really wanted to know what that was, because even though my clarity had not come back, I remembered that there was something like that going on. And then in 1975, 10 years into this thing, I came across a little book that's on our website, lostartsradio.com, called The Essene Gospel of Peace. And this was an account that I instantly recognized, not just the words, but the energy behind it. And this is one of the times that I remembered being around and working with this particular teacher, and it happens to be the one that is called Jesus or Yeshua in current times. And I mean, it's fine if you want to tell me that I'm imagining everything, but as far as I'm concerned, I was there. I remember, and I completely relate to everything in that book like something that we were doing. So this had a massive impact on me, and I started experimenting with it consciously on my own body because I still hadn't solved all of the health problems. And it was amazing, and it's all based on fasting and detoxification and connecting to nature in a conscious way and what were called angels and forces in nature and levels of God. And it was amazing stuff. And to me, it was like showing that the spiritual and the physical are not really separate. Nothing's really separate. And it's the same consciousness animating everything, except it looks different in the beginning. And the deeper you get into it, then your perception gets really different. So I started experimenting. What it was about was laws of nature. You know, for example, not laws like traffic laws where somebody's going to, you know, punish you if you break the law. It's just you're going to punish yourself because your body is designed for you to follow those design principles in order to be healthy and to have a smooth existence. And if you don't, then what we call diseases are the result. And that's what that little book was about, some people that were in that situation, and they had no idea why. So I went on doing trial and error and a lot of experimenting and a lot of stupid mistakes. I actually allowed and paid for some dentists to almost completely destroy my mouth by drilling holes in my teeth to make them healthy and putting mercury in them and all kinds of nonsense that, you know, obviously should have been known better. But when people get trained in a so-called higher education, and the teachers are very imposing and, you know, impressive, and they teach you to do totally ridiculous things like putting mercury in people's mouths, you believe it because you're so brainwashed. And that's not real education. It's just what is called education, and it's going on from preschool to PhD level and beyond in America and a lot of other places right now. I am completely in favor of education. Obviously, I do it. I'm involved in it all the time. I live the research that I'm still doing, and I realize that compared to what there is to know, I don't know anything yet and never will, really, compared to what, you know, the extent of what is. But it's enough to keep you really motivated, and I go on living that research. And things completely crashed in my life about 10 years ago, and I more or less lost everything I had on the physical plane. So what I'm doing here now is like being on a long business trip. And if I can share anything that's of any use to any of you, and even if you reject 99% of what I tell you and one thing turns out to be useful, then, you know, that's worthwhile. So that's, you know, fairly recently, just a few years ago, is when I was asked to be the co-host with Dane and Russ, and when Doug came to make the show possible. And when I started the health show, I thought it would be about natural healing and, you know, fasting and detoxification and raw food, exercise and sleep and all that kind of stuff. And it, we do talk about that, but it turned out that the main focus was more psychological than physical, although they're connected, obviously. And it was that if people know what to do to get healthier, why can't they do it? Or why don't they do it? Because they almost never do. And even people who go to famous health retreats, very often they'll follow what they learned for a while and then they'll quit. And sometimes that happens over and over again, and maybe the disease or the condition that they went to get over comes back. And then they say, oh no, I shouldn't have dropped my program. And then they may go back or just remember what they were taught to do, and they start doing it again. And a lot of times they get better. Nicholas Gonzalez, a famous cancer medical doctor in New York, who was killed recently, but I mean, obviously, for curing cancer, you're not supposed to do that sort of thing. By natural means, that's unforgivable. So he's not physically alive anymore. But he discovered some really amazing things. He was working on the teachings of discoveries of a guy named Dr. Kelly, who officially was a dentist, but he himself got cancer, Dr. Kelly did, and he was a real focused, attentive scientist, and he tried to see, well, what's going on? What's the cause and effect here? And he found, you know, how to put himself on raw food and on juices. He used carrot and celery juice, and it stopped the growth rate of his tumors, which were so big, he could feel if they were getting bigger or smaller. Made his own checking really easy. And he found that that stopped him, but it didn't get rid of him. And then there was a researcher named Dr. Beard around the beginning of the 20th century, I think, or the end of the 19th century. And he had written a paper on the use of enzymes for curing cancer. And they were pancreatic enzymes, the kind of enzymes that your pancreas, which is an organ in your center of your body there, that's an endocrine organ, and it makes, among other things, pancreatic enzymes, and it puts them into the gut, and it starts breaking down food. But there's something really interesting about pancreatic enzymes that Dr. Beard realized first, at least in modern times, and that was that when a structure called the trophoblast implants itself in the inner wall of the uterus when a woman is getting pregnant, and the fertilization takes place higher up, and then the embryo is traveling down toward the uterus, and it has to get connected to the uterine wall and get a blood supply, get kept alive, and all of this has to develop really fast, or there would be no way for the baby to survive. So the trophoblast is this invasive type of cell that burrows quickly into the wall of the uterus and hooks into the blood supply and acts a lot like invasive cancer. And if it kept growing, it would take over the body and kill the baby and the mother. But it doesn't. It just stops cold after its job is done. So Dr. Beard said, this is really interesting. What if we could do that with cancer? And so he started observing what was going on with that whole process. And he noticed that, you know, the baby, which obviously wasn't needing to digest solid food, very early on developed a pancreas that you would normally use for digesting your food. And it started secreting pancreatic enzymes. And his hypothesis, what he thought might be true, was that those enzymes stopped the trophoblast from becoming like cancer and killing the mother and the baby. And it turned out he was right. And Dr. Kelly read about that. He used it, and his tumors, which had just kind of stopped with the carrot juice and the raw food, they just started just falling apart, completely dissolving. And he could feel it with his hands because they were so big. And they just got completely wiped out by these enzymes only when he took them without food in between meals, which he just did by mistake one day and noticed that it worked. And so the only problem with that is after the tumor started dissolving, he started getting really sick. You can hear Dr. Gonzalez talk about this on a free YouTube video. I highly recommend it. Dr. Gonzalez has a lot of good videos there. He talks really fast, but he's incredibly educational. So Dr. Kelly started getting really sick, and somehow he got the inspiration that the reason he was really sick when the tumor was dissolving was that cancer tumors are incredibly toxic. And if they start dying, you know, even from natural means like with these enzymes, all this dissolved toxin goes into the blood, and it could really hurt or kill you. And so he went and was studying the Merck manual for ways of getting these toxins out. And before, I guess it was like up to 1975 or so, the Merck manual, which is this manual for medical doctors of different treatments, actually had enemas in there. You know, they would certainly never want to have anything natural in there now because it would get in the way of the drug business. But they hadn't been taken out when Dr. Kelly found them. And what they explained was, if you use diluted organic coffee in the enema, not only did it clean out the gut, which would get rid of the toxins faster, but the diluted coffee would open up the ability of the liver through the bile ducts to dump poisons that it was holding. And as soon as he started doing that, the effect of being real sick from the cancer tumors dissolving went away. It was an incredible discovery. And separately from him, Dr. Gerson, Max Gerson, in Germany in the 1930s, had discovered the exact same thing. And he was curing late-stage cancer patients with juices and raw food, but they were being killed by the painkillers, which they still are today. And they were taking narcotics because the pain of cancer can be so horrible that, you know, these people were taking massive doses of constant narcotics, which they do in hospitals like right now too, or other very nasty drugs. And he found out that if he used the coffee enemas, which were stronger than the regular ones, and for cancer patients, they were so toxic from the breakdown of these tumors that he had to use them constantly, you know, like every hour or so, instead of once a day, it was like every hour or half hour, that it helped so much get the toxins out of the body of the cancer patients that they could just quit the painkillers and they were fine. Well, they weren't fine. They didn't recover suddenly, but they didn't have the pain. This was an incredible discovery. And so coffee enemas were discovered by Dr. Gerson in the 60s and by Dr. Kelly, the mentor of Dr. Gonzalez, I guess in the 70s. And so this was an amazing discovery. And you, again, there are people like that. That Gonzalez was one of the most prominent medical doctors, MDs, that was curing cancer, advanced cancer cases. I mean, people with pancreatic cancer, which is one of the most aggressive, that they were supposed to die, you know, within a month or two, and they were doing great 30 years later. I mean, it was really obvious that he had discovered it. Now, Dr. Kelly, which Dr. Gonzalez took the same approach, found that people needed different kinds of diets, and I agree with that. But the ones that needed fat and more protein, he put on meat. And I would, you know, for me, I would much rather do that without meat, because at this point in my own perspective, I don't want to do anything to damage or torture or kill animals. It's important to me. So I found out that you can do the same thing, getting the protein and especially the fat, which meat is an important source of saturated fat and cholesterol, which you need. I get those from raw milk. And if it's not produced the wrong way, it becomes a superfood. And I guess the real clue that I got to the fact that it's so valuable is from our government, because I have learned to trust the federal government and all of its agencies implicitly. And the only thing is, you have to interpret what they say. So, for example, with food, usually if they say something is really terrible for you and will probably kill you if you eat it, it's usually a superfood and something that's wonderful. I mean, they could make mistakes and it could actually be bad for you, so you have to check. But in the case of raw milk, it turned out it is a superfood, and they're trying to eradicate it from the country completely. And they've almost done it, actually. And if they say something's really important, and, you know, vaccines or something like that, that they say is the best discovery of science in modern history, it's probably deadly, which turns out to be true with vaccines. But with the effort to eradicate raw milk, and of course, I just mentioned for all of our friends from spy agencies and other people that are listening right now, we're not giving any medical advice. I'm obviously not qualified for that. I'm not even a medical doctor. And if you need drugs or medical diagnoses or prescriptions for drugs or having your organs removed or anything like that in cutting edge science, then of course we recommend that you immediately go to your doctor and request to have everything done there. We're just talking about these various ideas, which at the moment is still legal in the U.S. at the moment, although that could change soon. But for the moment, we can talk somewhat freely. So anyway, with raw milk, it's almost eradicated in the U.S. It needs to be brought back, in my opinion. It's not unkind to animals in any way. You don't. There's an old model of dairy farming that hasn't been known on this planet for thousands of years. I think it was done at the time of Krishna and some of the Indian spiritual masters, and certainly at the time discussed in the Essene Gospel of Peace, Volume 1. You'll see in there they talk about raw milk, at least briefly. But in that model of producing dairy products, you don't kill the animals. I know it sounds really extreme, but no, you don't kill the animals. You're not supposed to do that. You share the milk with the babies. You don't kill the old animals when they slow down producing milk. And you don't kill the males because they're not needed. You know, they had a whole other system. And at one time, a few years ago, I actually called all over the world trying to find old Hindu temples and other places where they might remember, because they had great respect for animals a long time ago, they might remember how they did this kind of dairy, and none of them had any idea. So it's as close to a lost art on the physical level as I can really imagine. And the FDA and the other U.S. agencies are trying to finish it off at the moment by saying in the states like Arizona and other places where they will graciously allow you to sell raw milk in the stores, they say, oh, well, just make sure that it is grade A, right? Everybody knows grade A is wonderful. You know, the worst would be grade F, right? And the best would be grade A. What else do you have to know? But that's a total scam, because what grade A means is completely dead. And so if you cannot kill the product with heat, which pasteurization does, you can kill it with chemicals. So since it has to be called organic, they use something that's organically acceptable according to USDA, which is hydrogen peroxide. Not a healthy thing to consume. Even though, yeah, it produces oxygen and some things like that. They do use it as an adjunct cancer therapy in natural clinics. But by itself, it does not cure anything that I've ever seen. And it's definitely toxic. And so what these organically certified raw milk producers that sell in stores do is they put it in the milk. It kills all the microorganisms, which according to the government agencies are the source of evil and disease, and they're going to kill you, and they're a mistake of nature and all that. And it makes it a sterile product. So you buy this raw milk, which is technically raw as far as the heat is concerned, but it's totally dead. And in my way of looking at it, in my experience, I would say it's an extremely unhealthy thing to ever eat or drink. So I would say they've almost succeeded. And the real raw milk that hasn't been poisoned at this point pretty much has to be bought either in parking lots like heroin or at a farm where the farmer's not too afraid of being caught, you know, in depending on the laws of their state, by the government agencies. So I hope this is not boring to you. I just wanted to put out a bunch of stuff that gives you examples of the kinds of information that we can share and talk about. It's not religious, and even though it's called Church of the Essene Teacher, you're encouraged to honor and keep your religion and live it, and you know, show what it is by the life that you live and the person you become. Because it's not, you know, a name tag that really does it. It seems to me it's who you are. And if your belief systems are helping you, then that means you're becoming the incredible person that you were designed to be. And only you, you know, really know that and are just the judge of it. And I personally have respect for any religion that has that kind of effect. I'm just not as comfortable with the kind where you have to convert everybody else or kill them if they don't convert, or, you know, little things like that. But if it's something that's helpful to you and the other people that share it with you, then I think that's great. This is not about religion at all. This is about experience and the energy that I remember that was just the essence of beauty. It wasn't something that you'd put in words, or if you did, the words would not contain it well at all. They would not be sufficient. And what I have found is that the greatest teachers are not known by what they say. They're known by what they are. And the energy that comes out of them, even when they're silent, is overwhelming. If you ever meet one, it's like that. So I felt like since I had that privilege that, you know, I mean, I can't share it the way it should be shared. It should be done by somebody way farther along with the whole thing than me. But with the little bit of experience that I was able to have of it, I felt like that's what I'd like to try to share. And it can come in the vehicle of health information and stuff like that, because I've found that if you can get rid of your health problems and you can bring back a high energy that you experience all the time, you don't have to go through the usual sicknesses. You're not, you know, so vulnerable to infectious disease, and you don't fall apart while you age. I mean, that's useful, right? Because if you can stay feeling really good, then you can accomplish and do a lot more of what you want to do in your life. So to me, health is both a desirable end in itself, but it's also a stepping stone. Because if you can dispense with physical issues, then it's much easier to quiet your mind. And if you can ever quiet your mind without falling asleep, I mean, staying wide awake and observant, but still, you will be really amazed at what floods in, because there's something incredible inside. That life is not being created by a correct alignment of a bunch of atoms. There's something that is inadequately termed consciousness that is what we are, that I can't describe well at all, but you can experience it to greater and greater and greater degrees if you tune into it, learn how to do that, and to get extremely quiet, so that your mind stops chattering and arguing about everything and just is still. And it's okay to be still, because whatever is true is still going to be true. It's not going to dissolve just because we don't think for a minute. And, you know, we get so used to constantly thoughts racing through the mind that we kind of take that as our identity or parts of it. But there's an identity that's still there when that stops. And you don't have to wait till you die to figure that out and experience it. So, you know, any little parts of that that we could possibly share, I think would be good. And then I guess the other thing I wanted to look at was, I was looking at the all the stuff that's going on in censorship in the media right now. And the people who are talking about this stuff like natural healing and information about forbidden topics like vaccines and the healthcare system and GMOs and nuclear power and geoengineering, chemtrail fallout that we're all, you know, being sprayed with all the time. The people that are trying to spread real information about those things, the most recent thing, some of the really high profile ones are getting attacked through censorship. And so what it brought up was the whole issue of political activism. Oh, and it was another video I started watching talking about that also, and I thought it's a really important question, because a lot of these people in the videos are saying, look, if you're not out marching or at least talking to your congressman once a week, or, you know, going and trying to control your school board or whatever it is, then you're not responsible. And I partially agree with that, because like if you are in a position where you are sending your kids to public school, you probably should pay attention to what's going on there, because what they do to kids in public school now is really not friendly. And the parents need to take control and not let that happen if they're going to send their kids there or even any other school. They shouldn't just assume that everything is being done the way they would do it. And whatever you want for your kids, if you're putting them in somebody else's hands, then of course you have to, even though it's hard to find the time, you have to have some involvement with those people, or else they can just do anything. So certain kinds of political activism are important, and you might be in a situation where you are signing petitions, or maybe you do go see your congressman or whatever. But what I'm suggesting, And I'm not telling you what to do, because everybody has to follow their own inner guidance and be true to themselves absolutely, no matter what anyone else thinks about it. But what I'm suggesting and what we learned is that every single interaction between you and anybody else in your life is equally important. And since that's the case, it's not so much what you say, although that's important, but it's the energy behind what you say. So somebody can come up to you and say hello, and you feel really happy, you know, like celebrating. And then another person will come up and say hello, and you feel like they just dumped, you know, tar on you or something. And you think, wow, why is that? There's something called energy. And just because something is not visible in the wavelength to your eyes doesn't really necessarily mean it doesn't exist. And we are energy transmitters, and most of us are completely unaware of it. So if you do know about things like that, how do you become a responsible and contributing member of society and respond to this question about political activism and what you need to be doing? You know, should you be knocking on doors everywhere to tell everybody about GMOs or about chemtrails or about nuclear power when they're trying to make dinner or something like that, or go tell them that what, you know, whatever it is that they believe that you don't agree with is wrong and all these terrible things are going to happen? Or is there another way? So this might be kind of counterintuitive, but I'm suggesting that there is another way, and it's very powerful. And I know this sounds like it wouldn't do anything, but that's not the case. And that way is to work inside yourself. It does not mean to not go to the school board or the, you know, the water board or the congressman's office or anything. You can still do that. But what I'm saying is, since when you do interact with the congressman, besides letting him know about Bill 789 that he should sign or something, what he's going to be left with is the energetic impression of who you are. So if somebody comes in and is talking about a great cause, but their energy is all static and out of harmony, you could end up having the guy feel like he wants to fight, even though you didn't say anything unreasonable, and you don't even know why you think he's crazy, but he's just responding to your energy, and everybody else is responding to your energy all the time, even if they're not in your physical presence, if they're in your thoughts. So what I'm suggesting, and what, you know, I was fortunate to learn about in several different ways, is to pay attention to what happens in your outer life, because none of it is by chance. It's all beautifully and intricately designed so that tailored life lessons for each one of us are being served up to us on a platter in every single thing that happens and everybody that we interact with. And if you see that, instead of just seeing it as a bothersome interruption or, you know, somebody who's being illogical or difficult in some way, or a circumstance that you didn't want to deal with, or, you know, money was lost on something or whatever, look deeper, because there is something at a different level. And, you know, fixing your health ties right into it, because if you can do that, if you learn about laws of nature that have been forgotten for a long, long time, and you start living by them again, then the health problems go away. You know, there are some clues by what Gonzalez discovered and some of the good things they've done at Hippocrates and a bunch of other natural health places, but there's a whole set of natural laws that have been taught since before recorded history started. And they make you much stronger. They make you resistant to things. And we really need resistance right now, natural resistance, because we're being inundated with microwave radiation. Remember, we recently had a show with Barry Troer and Virginia Farver, and other people have been on the program talking about what cell towers do. We might get to have Josh Del Sol before too long, and some other people like that. We've got Katie Singer, the author of An Electronic Silent Spring, coming on soon. That's going to be exciting. And anyway, you know, they're starting to roll out the what they call small cell installations. In other words, to blanket the whole planet with microwave radiation that you can't move away from to the country, because they want to cover the entire rural landscape with these small cell towers. And I was asking Barry last time and the time before that, what are the solutions? And, you know, the solutions that he's talking about are if the government regains sanity, and I don't just mean the president or somebody visible, I'm talking about these vast bureaucracies, FCC and all the other ones, where they say, absolutely, you know, roll it out as long as we get money. It's great. Excuse me. It doesn't matter who dies or who gets cancer or whatever, you know, as long as I get a lot of money. And apparently, and we'll talk about this in a minute, you know, just in passing, that the guy who's heading the FCC now was involved with a $700,000 contribution to Obama and just happened to get this appointment and is now pushing the rollout of 5G that is going to be disastrous. So I talked to Ken Rolla, one of our recent guests, and he has technology at freshandalive.com. It's a really good website. He has technology that resists and helps to hold back microwave radiation, even some of the effects of chemtrails and HARP, nuclear power and things like that. And he's got the government seal of approval because they already tried to kill him and his family. And they usually don't waste time on inventors like that unless they have some things that are really valuable. So, you know, that's been interesting. But when I talked to Ken, we agreed that we're walking around barely alive here in terms of our consciousness. We think we know what's going on. We've got, you know, everything that we believe. But as far as actual self-awareness, we have almost none. And that potentially the human system, what your body's capable of, can outdo any technology that is man-made. The human body is an amazing creation, and we're seeing almost none of it. So we agreed on the human potential exceeding all possible technologies, and that this is the ultimate secret, because they could get rid of and shut down all the inventors who have good technologies. And if people become self-aware, then things are still okay. But if we fight each other and we're all wrapped up in this static of hating everybody that doesn't agree with us, or, you know, condemning people in our mind every minute and think this person's bad, that person's good, and waste all our time doing that, then the rulers are happy because they've got us diverted and we become, you know, ineffective, and they can finish us off per plan. And that is their plan. I mean, at the top level of governments and global corporations in the world is an incredible malice and bad energy that almost nobody would really comprehend. And if you did get in touch with it, then the challenge is it can just, you know, drive you crazy because it's so dark. And they have the technology, as Dr. Greer has pointed out, that's probably at least 100 years ahead of us, ahead of what we know. They've had gravity control, essentially fake UFOs they could fly around. They don't use, you know, they don't burn oil for those kind of craft. They mastered gravity control in the 1950s. They've got faster than light propulsion. This is not some kind of conspiracy theory. It's testimony from people at levels that were involved in these projects. And Dr. Greer's contribution is getting them to go public and risk their lives for the sake of exposing this information. So if they have all that technology, why are we still alive? Would be a logical question, right? I don't know the answer for sure, but looking at it logically, the only thing that I can think of, knowing that the people at the top levels of the power are involved in satanic worship stuff, and that, you know, this is the kind of thing they're into, is suffering and death and destruction. The only conclusion I come to so far is that we are involved in a ceremonial sacrifice, which has been popular for many, many thousands of years. But now it's the whole world and the biosphere that is the sacrificial animal. And it's not just an animal or a person, it's the whole world. And if they don't do it according to step-by-step procedure, and get it wrong, the God that they're worshiping to do this might get mad at them, which would be very bad for them. So they have to do it, you know, step by step, very carefully. And I think that's why we still have time. So the secret, as they go through those steps, that is the biggest taboo that I've ever come across, that they never want us to discover, is who we are and what our real capabilities are. The potential power because of where we're from and what it was that created us. And there are what's called fail-safes built in to those PowerPoints, so that if you do have malice and you want to see everybody suffer and die, you can't access those higher levels of power. It doesn't work. You're kept out by your own energy signature, so to speak, and they know that at the top levels. So the only thing they can do is keep us fighting each other, judging everybody around you in the sense of condemning them, you know, wanting to kill the bad people and all this stuff. And I don't mean stopping bad things from happening is one thing, but really getting into wanting the bad people to suffer. See, what's wrong with that is that on each side of that conflict, each side considers the other people bad, and that just goes on forever. So it's possible to want to stop all of the crime that is controlling the world right now without having any enjoyment of making anybody suffer. You don't need that. So that basically, and I'm sorry for the long roundabout explanation, but that's what this program is supposed to be about. So, you know, whatever we can do to lessen individual suffering with knowledge, you know, like how to avoid having your health destroyed if you don't have to, and, you know, get rid of as much avoidable human suffering that way as we can through education. And the other way is empower you as an individual to be this incredible light for the world because of the beauty and healing power that you actually are, regardless of what your mind says, and to get that back conscious and reconnect to the source. No matter what you believe, you can do this. And as long as, but you know, it's whatever you believe, but it's not whatever you feel toward other beings. You have to have not just forgiveness, because that assumes that there's something to forgive. You have to see the person as, you know, it's been said to love your neighbor as yourself. You can't do that unless you come to realize that they are yourself. And then it becomes automatic. So that's kind of an ideal state that we'd like to get closer to. And it brings in, instead of life being mundane and kind of gray colored and, you know, all these hard tasks that you have to do, and you just get home and you want to get drunk, or either, whether it's with alcohol or a TV show or whatever, and you want to forget so that you won't be aware of what's bothering you and fall asleep as soon as possible. Instead of kind of a dreary outlook, it's bringing back an energy of magic that makes things exciting. And no, I don't mean black magic or some horrible, you know, scary thing or anything like that. I mean that incredible energy of the life force that's flowing through you that is your normal state that we have gotten separated from. And when you look at, you know, things going on in the outside world, I mentioned one of them, which is the 5G rollout. And I mentioned another one too, the censorship of the major leaders in education through the media, like Alex Jones and Mike Adams and people like that. And all kinds of malicious news that's designed to mislead and enslave people. The only way that it's even safe to find out about those things without getting yourself all upset is to learn to split your energy, your attention, and use your intellectual and analytical faculty to look at the outside world and understand what you need to for strategic purposes and to make better decisions in your own life. Protect yourself. Learn what's going on in the school so you can protect your kids, and what's happening in your water supply so you don't drink fluoride, and all the things that education is useful for. But that's the intellectual part. And the emotional part, which is completely different, is what you're the way I've explained it before, it's like eating on the emotional level. And even though on physical food, when you want to get detoxified, you can fast that means you don't eat for a while, so your body can rest and get cleaner. You can't fast on the emotional eating level. You're always eating 24 hours a day. So if you're allowing that part of yourself to hook on to what you're thinking about, and it's something really nasty or that has a bad feeling to it, that's the energy that you're absorbing emotionally, and it can destroy you physically even. And so it's better not to do that, because you feel a lot better if you don't. And the way to avoid it is you take that emotional connection and leave it on whatever for you is most inspiring and beautiful and uplifting, and you do not move it unless it's to something else even better or just as good. And then the intellectual part of your mind can learn about, you know, all these terrible things that are going on if you have to, and use the information for your benefit, but you don't get weighed down by it at all. It is possible, and all you have to do is try it out and practice it. So that's about the main thing. Now, the reason I, you know, was going to stop this show, and I almost escaped and got to quit a couple weeks ago, is because we got very few people calling in. And I found out later, after I had decided we should stop, that really there were quite a few people listening to archives, which you may be. And we never heard from them calling in, but they still valued the show. And I'll, you know, we'll try to do that. But we're not going to, I'm not going to talk for 3 hours. I'm sure you're glad about that. An hour is a really long time, and probably more than you wanted anyway. And sometimes it might be less than that. If you don't call and you're just listening on the archives, then I'm going to make the shows short. And if we gradually eventually get people wanting to call while it's live, like, you know, at this time of night on Saturdays, then I'll hang around and we'll do a little bit longer show and answer questions and talk about issues that you think are important. It's your choice. But, you know, one thing is, I know the health stuff, and I know some things about consciousness and certain areas like that, but I don't know anything about how you get anybody to be aware that you have a radio show. So we've been doing this for a while now, and, you know, we don't have the giant audience that some of the other shows have, just because most people don't even know we exist. So in the last 2 or 3 weeks, I've had an offer from a lady that is very successful with that to help us, and I suspect we're going to be getting a lot more listeners in the near future, because it's going to start getting out about the show for people that may be interested. And so I think we're going to probably have some people calling out of that. But whichever way it goes, it's fine with me, whatever happens. One thing that she did tell me is that if you like the show, and, you know, either one of them, either the Saturday show or the guest show on Sundays, has really interesting people on it, you can see those on YouTube. And most people don't know we're even on YouTube. If you go there and you do what's called liking the video and subscribe, apparently that helps us get more exposure. I don't know all the mechanics of it, but it, she said it definitely is helpful and important. I have never asked people to do that, but I'm going to try to remember now. So go to the Lost Arts Radio YouTube channel, like the videos as many as you watch, and subscribe if you like them. I mean, if you don't like them, you don't have to put like, but hopefully you will like them. And apparently that'll help us. And I didn't mention that tomorrow night we have Madeline Innocent, who I followed her work for years. She's a great lady who happens to be a homeopath. And we'll tell you guys what homeopathy is if you're not already familiar with it. But one of the unusual things with her is she does a lot of her work with animals, people's pets. And I think you'll find that really interesting if you're interested in animals or have pets. She is in Australia in the area of Perth, where some of our listeners are over there, and hopefully they can listen at when we have the show at this time of day. She'll be on tomorrow night, 6 o'clock Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern U.S. time. Should be incredible. She's a great person, and it's a great privilege for me to get to meet and talk to people like this. then also, if you're new and you don't know about our site, it's lostartsradio.com. And we're putting up constant educational videos and articles there that I think you might find useful. Another way that, there's also a donate button there. If you have money and you're able to help us continue our work, we'd really appreciate it. Donate button is on lostartsradio.com or lostartsresearchinstitute.org, which is our nonprofit. And either one of those, that's extremely helpful, but only if you have the money that you're able to help us out. If not, if you ever do any shopping on Amazon, then if what I found out is if you go to, instead of Amazon.com, you go to no W's, but just smile like you're smiling, you know, smile.amazon.com. And it takes you right to Amazon. It's the same thing, but they have a list of IRS approved nonprofit charities, one of which is Lost Arts Research Institute in Arizona, which is ours and our research arm. And if you choose that one, then whenever you spend $100 on Amazon, it takes 50 cents and donates it to Lost Arts Research Institute, which is, you know, all we need is about $1 billion in Amazon shopping and we could build our school. So anyway, that's a way to start. If you want to do that, that's helpful too. There's also the free newsletter there is on lostartsradio.com. Besides the donate button, there's also a forum which you can discuss any of the things that we talk about on the radio or anything else important in your life during the week. And as we get more listeners realizing that we're here, that I think is going to become a really interesting discussion forum. If you have suggestions or comments or anything, that questions, anything you want to say about the show or anything else, and you want to get them to my attention, just write richard@lostartsradio.com. I will see them all. And I think that's about it. And hope you have a great week. And gradually we'll start talking to you live on the show. We'll see you next time.